Well, the storm has hit. It's not so bad yet. It's just some wind and a little bit of rain, but sort of blustery, that's all. Supposed to be a lot more later on, but I'm not going out storm chasing. I'm just saying, well, you know, so what, there's a storm. Maybe just ignore it. I'm trying to just ignore it. Perhaps this is the right way to go, huh? Is the storms in the world, the turmoil, just ignore it. Or just look at the beauty of it, but don't get up in the hype and the hysteria and all this kind of stuff. So I'm trying to do just that, and I've been having to try to see if I could fix the audio inputs. I've had terrible problems, and hopefully this is recording well. And sometimes if there's little sort of buzzing or audio interference, you know, just see if you could just overlook that. Because it's the overall tone of what's being said that's important. Now, last night I had this experience, and it was this experience of no world. I recognize there's no world at all. The world is just imaginary. The belief that anyone is in a world is simply untrue, entirely untrue. We're in intrinsic spaciousness, which is the same everywhere. Everything actually nothing arises at all, and neither rises nor subsides. It never leaves the ground of being at all. There's no such thing as arising. But I saw this. It flashed very clearly, and I said, "Oh, so those who want to be in self conflict, who want to pretend that they're in conflict with the self, the one self, they end up believing that they're in a world." This is what happens. But I saw that there is no world at all. Nobody's in a world. No one's in a world at all. Nothing's in a world. Plants are not in a world. This is just a convention we have of overlooking the truth. Everything's in eternal life. Everything's in eternal life. But in order to try and separate this, we think that there's a world. There's a world here and there's a non-world somewhere. You might just say there's just one world, which is everything everywhere. Instead of this little separate, thinking this little a planet, some dirt, some rock is some separate world. It's not true. Nothing's in that context at all. Nothing is abiding in a world. Everything's abiding in being, in the one beingness. So I saw this very clearly. I was just like, wow. This is true. It's very true. Very easy to see. It's just a decision to stop being loyal to silliness. So, nobody is crazy. Nobody's insane. Nobody is sick, mentally crazy, and sick. But what the trouble is here is that almost everyone is very loyal to silliness, or very loyal to insanity. But insanity also is just intrinsic spaciousness, really. So there's nothing that ever leaves sanity, actually. So we're here on a Saturday afternoon, and just taping. It's a very slow day. Haven't done much. Spent so much time on electronics trying to get stuff to work. It's amazing how simple stuff should be, and it's not. And there's always glitches, and it just consumes your life. It's purposeful. Those who are loyal to silliness are loyal to delay. What else can silliness be but just delay in recognizing that it's silly? That's it. So this delay has to be very fanciful and seem to be very self-important, and it's, you know, a lot of this is important, but it's all just delay and recognizing, oh, this is just silly, actually. Now, the auspiciousness of these times is huge. I think, what's today, like the 7th? And the reports I get is people are feeling very tired. I had muscle pains yesterday, then I simply kept having right mental focus, and then poof, they vanished. So it's a time when our mind is so concerned. and jittery, that all sorts of symptoms may arise. And I just exercised this morning, did everything I needed to do, haven't eaten anything today. Just staying with the right habits, that's all. Staying disinterested in quote-unquote the world. There is no world. There is no world. So I'm getting pressure from various angles now. You can feel the pressure in the world starting to build up. And that's starting to show now. That requires us to, you know, up our game. Absolutely, we have to keep upping our game. Because the turmoil is coming, and this is a perfect metaphor here. And there's actually spray coming in here from the wind. That's a powerful, pretty powerful turmoil right now I'm looking out on. And yet here, it's calm where I am. Very calm, not perfectly calm. There's a little motion of breeze, but and everything is fine. It's likely that most will fall, take a tumble right now. It's very likely. And I experienced a friend yesterday taking a tumble, but I didn't do anything. I just watched. I said, "You're okay. You're okay." I just said, "You're okay. You're fine. That's not bad. You're okay." I saw it, and it shouldn't be anything hurt. He was like kind of worried and shocked. Maybe I hurt something. But and looking at it clearly, I said, no. He tumbled just right. It's fine. He'll be fine. And he was. But initially, there's kind of a worry and a shock. You take a tumble. So my job is just to reassure you that you're fine. Everyone's fine. Everything will be fine. It'll turn out all right in the end. Don't worry. You will bounce back. There's just a little clever trap that's been set in here to make you believe there's a world and bodies and all of that. It's all nonsense. And yet, still believing in nonsense, being loyal to nonsense, hoping that loyalty will somehow sanctify you, whereas you're already sanctified. So really, we're holding on to silliness, hoping that loyalty to silliness will sanctify us, and yet we're already perfectly sanctified, inherently so. Everything is perfectly sanctified as eternal life. And yet we're trying to sanctify ourselves by loyalty to silliness. So just see this concatenation, this chain of silliness. just recognize it. Like Ramana said, just remove ignorance. You don't have to attain realization. It's already there. Just remove ignorance. The sun is already there. Just remove the clouds. You don't have to establish the sun. Perfect the sanctification of eternal life is already all there is. There isn't anything other than that. But we're trying to sanctify ourselves, sanctify reality through loyalty to silliness. So look at it this way. Very diplomatic language here, which is helpful. Not conciliatory. We're not offering a compromise, no. But what we're offering is gentle language here. Not a compromise. There's no such thing as compromise. Eternal life, there's only eternal life everywhere. What compromise? With what? With what? If people are talking about compromise, well, first say, well, with what? With nothing? Well, there's nothing there to compromise with. So it's an absurdity to say compromise. It's silliness. It's loyalty to silliness. More loyalty to silliness. That's the most common one is compromise. Say, okay, I'll just be a little silly. Now, silliness is totally silly. You can't be a little silly, actually. You can't say that you're just going to sanctify a little bit of yourself. But that's a denial of the totality, that there's only eternal life. That's a total denial. See, the truth is there's only eternal life. That's all there is. So to say that there's something else is a denial of truth and reality. It's a total denial. It's a total denial. Any denial of reality is a total denial. This can't be emphasized enough. Any denial of reality is a total denial. Not a partial denial. There's no partiality to reality at all. So to try and establish partiality is a total denial of the nature of reality. The seamless oneness of eternal life. So again, this is our Achilles heel, is we keep thinking, well, I'll just be a little denial. I'm just in a little denial. No such thing. There's no such thing. This is delusion. The worst delusion is to think you're in a little delusion. I have a little delusion. I'm only denying a little bit of reality. That's the worst delusion. Repentance is to realize there is no middle ground in terms of something, some other. There's no otherness. So how could there be a middle ground between all that is and no otherness? How could there be a middle ground there? Of any type. I'll check the audio on this, make sure it's recording properly. Okay, yeah, it is. Great. I can't buy this type of headset. I'm really worried about it because they don't make them anymore. But I finally found one that was very difficult, and it buzzes like that. It's unusable. It's just simple two stereo jacks. Stereo jack for the audio, stereo jack for the microphone, stereo jack for the headphones. Very simple. Super basic, simple. But the new computers only use one jack, a triple jack for audio. I mean, microphone and audio, just one jack. So they don't make these double jacks anymore. You see how everything gets pressured to be phased out, and you have to, go with something else. And I mean, this works fabulously. It works great. There's no reason to change it. Or if you're going to give one jack, make the option at least for two. But. So if this headset stops working and showing signs of doing so, this is a problem. I don't know what I'll do. Well, I have a workaround, I believe. I'll figure it out. Yeah. But it's cumbersome. It's not good. So what middle ground can there be between everything and nothing and no other? There's no other. So if there's no other, where's the middle ground again? Where's the middle ground between everything and no other at all? There's no other at all. It can't be a middle ground. It has to be accepting a premise. First you have to accept the premise of an other, which is, how is that a compromise? With everything, with saying there is no other. That's a totally different premise. That's a total denial of reality, right off the bat. And then you say, okay, well, now there's a middle ground. No, wait. First, let's have where's the middle ground between your premise and reality? So we overlook that, and we take it as a given that there's an other, and then we claim, well, let's be reasonable, let's get some compromise here. But the position that there's an other, that itself is an absolute position. So let's look at that first. It's an absolute denial of reality. So where's the compromise there? If you want a compromise, show me the compromise there of saying that there's an other. Partial other? Then we're just getting into silly games. That's silliness. It's still an other. However big or small you want to call it, say it is, it's still the belief in otherness. No matter how you label the belief in otherness, it's still a belief in otherness. And that's so that's why we get into all these labels and argue over labels, but we're trying to hide this central issue here, aren't we? We're trying to hide it, disguise it, discourage looking at it. So really the path is just, you know, being willing to look at this, look at the mind and the little games it's playing. Look at our mind, the games it's playing. So first comes in the front, the wind comes first. As a pressure gradient differential that is, you know, there's a lot of turmoil of the hot and cold air, warm and cool air mixing, causes a lot of turbulence. And then once that front passes, you get a more of a steady situation where the deluge comes here. But right now we're in this turbulent phase, and we're in a turbulent phase right now, very apropos, a couple weeks before the inauguration. It's a lot of pressure gradients taking place in everyone's mind. And then after the inauguration will be the deluge. But I would say one of the keys is to realize that you're not in a world at all. You're in eternal life, spaciousness. The spacious, perfect, the everywhere spaciousness of eternal life. That's where you are right now. That's where everything is. So our belief that we're in a world is like really the prison. It's really the prison. Because everybody say, well, how could you get free? Well, get free of what? There's no world to get free of. We're already free. And we're not even free of a world. We're not free of something. Freedom isn't freedom from something. Freedom is the freedom to express our creativity any way we want to, but it's never freedom from something. There is no other to be free of. There's no world to be free of, actually. That's all just our silly imagination. And the body seems to be so solid and here, you know, in a world, but that's just the mind's imagination. The body does whatever the mind appears, however the mind wants, imagines it to appear. If it wants to appear as flesh and blood and like that, it will appear that way. But it's not, we're free to have it appear any which way we want to, actually. There is no real body at all. Just appearances that are not arising at all. Nothing arises out of eternal life. There's no life that comes out of eternal life that never has never happened, never will. So nothing, everything, it's like a screen. I'm moving like towards you. There's nothing really coming towards you. It's still a flat screen, isn't it? So however much we want to pretend that something's happening, everything, all the pixels are still exactly where they've always been, right, in their computer. The pixels haven't moved from their position at all. It's just a play of light. So nothing is rising up out of eternal life and then subsiding back into it. I saw this morning. This is like guru vision. I said, oh yeah. And then I come across this post from Lhotshawa House, which gives these wonderful translations of Tibetan Buddhist texts, and it's some lama meditation master in the 19th century, I believe, giving an homage to Longchenpa, a beautiful garland of flowers, an homage to Longchenpa. It's beautifully written, just, you know, tremendous. And he talks about Longchenpa's what Longchamp's pointing to and points out. Longchamp's the appearance of the fullness of all of Buddha's teachings, the perfect fullness of it, the perfect fullness and clarity of it. It's a good way to express it. Buddha got everything going, got all the momentum going, which I say that's the most difficult thing to do, right? Just like Jesus got Christianity going, that's the most difficult thing to do. But then Longchenpa came as the fulfillment of clarity about it all, and put it all into this beautifully crystal clear, saying, you know, this is what it's really about. Okay, let's just realize this is it. So we have the benefit of all this right now. We have great benefits. You have to get benefits where you can get them. And no one tradition has a stranglehold on the Dharma, okay? So that's why I'm ecumenical. I'm ecumenical because I get help from all different angles. And I find I like that approach better for me than trying to just say just one rigid, you know, approach, a one rigid tradition or something. I have to just that. I can only do that. Because I found that the contributions from, for instance, Jesus have been immensely helpful for me to understand what Longchenpa is getting at. And then vice versa. Longchenpa's clarity has been super helpful to clarify what Jesus is getting at. And with Ramaharshi, it all is supportive of one another. The Dharma is supportive of the totality of the Dharma. So being ecumenical, I find, is actually a great help. Many are stuck because they think they have to adhere to just one religion. And you can tell they're very frustrated, very stuck. It's not working well for them. And they just think, well, if I just got to be loyal to this, you know, well, I mean, what they're being is loyal to their own silliness. So they're still caught in that. They're still caught in loyalty to silliness, hoping that will sanctify what they are, which is totally redundant. What we are is eternal, already eternal life. It's always been. So I am quite sure the success that I've had is due to my ecumenical nature. I'm grateful for help coming from anywhere. Even when someone curses me, I actually, somebody wrote a kind of a very, you know, harsh comment. And after that, that's when I got the glimpse of there's no world. So it was like extremely helpful. But I took it the right way. I kind of said, well, what is this? How is this going to help me? And I didn't get too upset. I was like, wow, what can I say? How can I respond? I don't know. But then I realized that I said, hey, if you want to be, imagine that you're in conflict with yourself, you're free to do so. I'm not standing in your way at all. I'll love your path. You're doing that just the same as I love everything. You're free to do that, and I love your freedom. That's all. But it's just you'll believe that you're in a world then. But I see very clearly there's no such thing as a world. And I'm free also to not imagine conflict with the self. Conflict coming from where? From some imaginary otherness? There's no otherness. The imaginary otherness is what we call the world. We're just imagining there's this otherness to reality, something otherness to reality called the world, and bodies, and we're in this bodies in a world that there's no truth to that at all. We don't have to do anything to make it true. It's already that there's no world and that there's no bodies in a world. That doesn't mean that the tree's not going to be there and this so-called body's not going to be. It's just that you realize there's no world. The tree's not in a world. it's in the eternal lifeness without any otherness at all. So I don't know what's going to happen. I can feel the pressure. It's coming. I just got notified of something tomorrow, which is going to cause a great deal of upset here for sure. So the hammer is being put down on me, And so I need help, you know, as far as from the Dharma Kings. I need pragmatic help. Wow. Okay. I just said the hammer's coming down, and these two big old pieces of wood just were blown over by the wind, and they just slammed down right here on the right of me. Two of them. Wow, the timing was immaculate there. Okay, so what does that mean? Well, they're flat now. Before they were upright, now they're completely flat. And they can't be touched by the wind now. They can't be touched by the wind. So the vision of this flatness, of nothing arising out of intrinsic spaciousness, should make me impervious to the turmoil in the world. It makes the mind impervious to it. And they fell beautifully, just all together, two together. Boom! This is more commotion than we've had in a long time in California. This is some genuine commotion here. Yeah, the atmosphere is very full of turmoil now. Everywhere. Complete turmoil in all directions. Everywhere you look, everything's flying in some different direction. You know, it's just a really atmosphere of commotion right now. So there's no doubt that those who are loyal to silliness are going to put their foot down right now and said, everybody has to be loyal to silliness. That's my salvation. And they try to control you. And I say, no, you're free to be loyal. I'm free to not be loyal to silliness. But they don't go for that. So, well, they insist that you see yourself in a world. I insist that I'm not in a world. And they say, well, get out of here. Well, get out of where? There isn't any world to get out of. And they say, well, you're crazy. I say, no. I mean, you're just being loyal to silliness. There's only eternal life everywhere. There's no demarcations, actually, at all. Saying that, well, life arises here. So life arises everywhere. Life arises in the mind. It doesn't arise in a world. Life arises in the mind. It doesn't arise in a world. There are no worlds. A dream world is not a world. It's just a fantasy arising in the mind. So the dharmic way to respond to pressure is to just go into this thankfulness and gratitude for the perfect help that the Dharma Kings have already envisioned. And so it's already there. Their plan already has worked. It's just that we're avoiding it because of the wow factor. We're afraid of the sublime. I mean, any of us who can handle, you know, ugliness in this world, we most people watch it constantly on television. It's just like this non-stop, you know, vomiting of ugliness on television, actually. Horrible, horrible vomiting there. That's all it is. And most of them are totally used to that. So it's the sublime. If you thought you were going to see the subtle bliss body, the Sambhogakaya of Buddha, Manjushri, Longchenpa, Jesus Christ, Rama Maharshi, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, Jamyang Khyentse Chokyi Lodro, etc., Padmasambhava, that beauty into some just sublime, you that give you the jitters. That give us the jitters. Because we might forget about the belief in a world. And they say, well, where am I then? Well, where have I always been? and abide in us. So, abide in us as eternal life. So we're afraid of the sublime. We're afraid of the sublime. So we're afraid of good fortune. So we have to spend our time in gratitude for just the tremendous help that we're about that we have already subtly received, but that we're about to receive in an even more sublime way. This already happened. So in other words, the rescue has already happened. Don't plead for rescue. Focus on that the rescue has already happened. So this is a very clear-cut, no otherness type of practice, right? You're either praying for rescue or in gratitude and wowness that the rescue has already happened. At least those are the clear-cut options. And we don't want to obscure that, the clear-cut options that we have. You see, if we have clear-cut options, why do we then try to obscure this through quibbling? It's silly. Loyalty to silliness. So we have these two clear-cut options. Either we're praying for rescue. Help, 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 God. We have such a bad situation. Please, I don't see you doing anything. You know, you got to help me out. There's that, or you say... Are you saying, wow, God, what a great job you did in rescuing me. I'm so grateful that I've already been totally rescued. It's so amazing. It's just wonderful. So those are two super clear-cut options, right? That you can't possibly confuse the two when you're looking at the two options. You can go into nitpicking and labeling and quibbling and all this stuff to obscure the clarity of the two options, but they're still there. It's like I could either eat or not eat. And he said, well, you know, maybe you could like eat a little bit. So, but that's obscuring the clarity of the options. I can either stay or go, for instance. I can either sit here or leave where I'm sitting. Well, you could crawl away. That's still leaving. You know, so that's nitpicking. And that's bringing confusion into the mind of seeing what your options are. So... We can pray by saying help, or we can say thank you. Pray by saying thank you. Just wow, what a fabulous job you did. But we're afraid of fabulousness, aren't we? We're very afraid of it. So I spend my time, my moments, trying to keep going back to the wow of gratitude. Like, wow, what a fabulous situation I'm in now. I'm just like... so blessed. Super blessed. So I just imagine that I'm super blessed in like an ideal situation. Just an absolutely wonderful abode and situation. And I have to get used to this. Leading a super blessed life. I've already agreed to this, but that means now I have to apply myself. So it takes a lot of effort. It takes much more effort to be in a super favorable position than it does to be in a wretched position. We're already totally used to being in wretched positions. So we're so familiar with it. It's like, same old, same old. Same old, same old. So it seems the easy way just to stay in a wretched situation. You say, I don't have to apply myself. I can just, you know, vegetate and watch television. Yeah, that's true. But you won't get out of a wretched situation that way. But if we are willing to be industrious in our mind and wow our super fortunate situation and continually realize we have to really work at that, really work at that, really work at that, really work at that, then we'll get the super fortunate situation. I'm aware, for instance, of super beautiful places. I'm aware of other realms, actually, also. Pure lands, paradise realms, death-free realms. So it's really fortunate to even be aware of that. And then I'm aware of some place here in this world, some places that are very beautiful, and I really love them. They're so peaceful. I said, oh, such a peaceful, non-turbulent abode. Wonderful place. So I'm aware of those. So that's very fortunate. Most are not even aware of it. I try to tell them about it. They don't pay any attention at all. Because, it's weird. They just refuse to pay any attention. Because it scares them. They don't want anything too sublime. So I look at pictures, of such a place, pictures I've taken, and try to stay in touch with how sublime it is. But I'd certainly like to. The advice from the Queen of Wow, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, the Queen of Wow, is he says, make sure that you find an abode that is particularly conducive to success on the path. It's very peaceful and conducive. A very conducive abode, she says that this is really important. Well, that came right, I think yesterday, or the day before yesterday, right at the right moment when I was worrying about this. And I've had assurances from her that she'll get the job done. You know, get the right abode will be set up, will happen, that will happen. Now, there seems to be a lot of obstacles in the way, but the Dharma, she's an expert at removing obstacles. You know, the Dharma kings are experts at that. So I just don't worry about how they're going to do it. I just focus on that it's a done deal and prepare my mind to be in a really wonderful, wonderful abode. So just believe that the Dharma kings will remove all obstacles for you. And our job is to focus on, I'm willing to wow my good fortune. You have to work at it. You don't want to go running away saying, oh, guys, that's just too nice. I can't stay here. No, you say, no, I'll get used to it. I'll have to get used to it. I'll just get used to it. Familiarity is the great power that we have. Either for good or for bad, for us, for good fortune or bad fortune. So if we just say, you know, hang in there, and you say, it's so difficult, I don't know if I can, but to hang in there, gradually familiarity takes place, and in one day you'll just kind of feel like, I got this, yeah, I feel comfortable, and that's familiarity kicking in. So we have to wait for familiarity to kick in. So if you're not familiar with something, then you're totally biased against it, just from the standpoint of familiarity. So no reason, no explanation works, because familiarity, the bias of familiarity gets in the way. So that's why those who just wait for explanations wait in vain. You have to repent, stop believing there's some otherness, and some middle ground to a non-existent otherness. Stop being loyal to silliness, to sanctify what's already inherently sanctified, and can't be any more sanctified than it already is. See, we're already perfectly sanctified. We can't be more sanctified than we already are. So, all this effort to sanctify what we are is nothing. There's nothing is happening. There's no effect really from it. It's just meaningless, actually. It's just totally meaningless. So the Holy Spirit told me to stay away from this storm. That's what the heads up I got yesterday. That you're going to be tripped up in an unexpected way. It might be standing water or something. I actually went through standing water yesterday. It's a mistake. There might be a lot of flooding. There could be cars spinning out of control. You know, there could be all sorts of stuff. It's best, I'm just going to stay off the roadways today and Sunday. Just stay home. I mean, that's just a wise thing to do. I'd love to go out take video of this all, but God indicated that I shouldn't do that. The Holy Spirit very powerfully gave me this object lesson. The Holy Spirit can work. People say, how does the Holy Spirit work? In all ways. There's no way that it can't work in. It will get the message through to you if you pay attention. And it's capable of working in any which way. I mean, you could notice a dewdrop at the right angle, at the right moment, and suddenly you realize, oh, yeah. Okay, so that's what I'm supposed to do. Or a leaf, or nothing at all. Or a piece of dust, or a word, a motion, anything at all. If it's the Holy Spirit sets it up so your attention suddenly looks within and says, oh yeah, okay, now I understand, now I get it. It's the play of attention. Chilly out here. I can see why it's snowing. I'm sure it's snowing in the Sierras big time at this point. Problem is though, when weather's like this, they just start eating, right? You're sitting in the house, bored, nothing to do. It's like, let me start eating. That's something to do. Nervous energy. I want to eat and do something. So that's trouble. I still haven't lost weight. I thought I'd be real low this morning. I wasn't. I wasn't at all. I actually gained a little weight. It's like, wow. Amazing. I did snack on a little bit of peanut butter last night. I was getting so hungry, so I better get a little something. Did my balance work this morning? I tried to do it every morning. It's getting better and better. Okay, it you notice improvement. And this is a good example. The storm is raging in all different directions, and I feel calm. I don't feel disturbed or anything because I feel like my balance is so good that nothing can really, you know, push me out of balance, really. Like a palm tree, just able to stay grounded. But there's going to be so much turbulence, and here's another very important point to make here, is let's just sidestep temptation altogether. I decided to do that. I said, okay, yeah, I'll play it that way this time. Maybe next time, maybe next cycle, there'll be some huge turmoil, and I'll play it more dangerously. Okay, fine. But I've had enough suffering for this lifetime. So maybe some down the road, I might feel differently. But for this one, I'm just going to avoid temptation altogether. Just sit it out. Sit this one out. Just stay away from temptation. To upset and anger and turmoil and all that. Just don't be tempted. So that's different than having the temptation and then being able to say no to it. That seems very heroic, doesn't it? But that's what the ego wants. That's what silliness wants, because that's the only hope silliness has, is that temptation, you'll fall to temptation. And then you'll help, they think that's helping sanctify what they are, because you're being silly too now. In other words, you fall prey to silliness. And you go back to loyalty to silliness. So that's what they're hoping for, that you'll be loyal too. And that will, they'll say, oh, I'm not the only one. Okay, you're being loyal too. Okay, great. That reassures them. See, the world, silliness wants to, always trying to reassure itself that, yeah, this is the right thing to do. Why? And say, well, everybody else is doing it, so it must be okay. So they try to get everyone here to engage, be loyal to silliness. Because silliness is very insecure. It's like, because it says, well, what if I stop being silly? It's so easy to stop being silly. There's nothing to it, actually. So, just got to keep being loyal. What else is there to do? It's more wind and rain than I know. Yeah. So balance work is really, really important. It gives you this little edge, like, hey, I can sit it out. You don't feel a need to prove anything so much. You've already proved it to yourself that the balance is good, so you don't need to prove it to the world, because the world's going to play rough with you and unfair and tricky. Actually, there's no world, but loyalty to silliness plays tricky and unfair and devious. So let's just avoid all that stuff for now. Because there is no world, there is no otherness, there is no middle ground between no otherness and everythingness at all, none whatsoever. How could there be? It's absolutely absurd to even try and imagine that this is possible. And of course, you cannot speak to absurdity at all. Loyalty to silliness. They just refuse, you know, any dharmic talk at all. They become conciliatory. But conciliatory is not compromise. It just means that, well, I'm not going to appear to object to what you say. I'm just not going to accept it. I'll reject what you say in a nice way. That's conciliatory. I'll reject what you say in a nice way. Something like that. They're not really shifting over to what you're saying, not at all. And they just don't understand what you're talking about, actually. Because silliness doesn't understand non-silliness. It doesn't understand it at all. It feels threatened by it. There's no way to put truth into a silly context. See, there's no way to put truth into a silly context of otherness. There is no otherness. You can't put truth into a context of otherness. There is no otherness. And you say, well, just put a little bit of truth into a context of otherness. Same thing, completely silly. There is no otherness. That would be like an abyss. You're just bringing up the notion of an abyss immediately. That's what we would say, right? To put yourself into otherness means to imagine an abyss. There is no otherness. So all you could do is imagine that you're in some abyss. That's not little. An abyss, is there some littleness to an abyss? The feeling of an abyss? How could there be a little abyss? An abyss is that you don't see anything other than the abyss. That's what an abyss is. The definition, the meaning of it. So how could there be a little abyss? 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 I don't want the computer blown off the stand here. It's really blustery. How could there be a little abyss? Just ask. That's a wonderful question, isn't it? A wonderful dharmic wowness. A wonderful wowness. I've never heard this before. So this comes from the grace of the Dharma kings. Just look at this absurdity. A little abyss? A little abyss? Isn't that total absurdity? It's total absurdity. Absurdity is always total. A little abyss. The Zuri says, no, just imagine a little abyss. This is a big lie, isn't it? That's the big lie. Just you'll be okay. Just imagine a little abyss, or just in a little abyss. That won't be bad. Again, how could there be a little abyss? So we're just looking at this, okay, and wowing it. Just wow. Having gotten to this is big time. It is big time. And yet we're just gently looking at it here. Trying to stay warm. Oh, good Lord. I could use some warmer weather right now. How about like 70? Calm and 70. Yeah, that would be nice. So just kind of savor having gotten to this question. How can there be a little abyss? Isn't that a super, super statement, really? Or not really, it's not a question, it's a statement. How could there be a little abyss? How could there be a little abyss? Again, the whole purpose of an abyss, the notion of it, is that you don't see anything other than the abyss. That's an abyss. In every direction you look, all you see is nothing at all. You know? And however far you go or think or whatever, there's still just nothing at all. It's just an abyss. That's the definition. So how can we say, bring in the absurd notion of little abyss? Now you might be feeling a bit upset at this thing. That's such a dirty pool, isn't it? To bring in that little abyss. And so I've just been deceiving myself this way all along. So that's why I've been suffering so much. But just stay in drawing no conclusions. Just stay in the wow. Just stay in the wow. But don't draw any conclusions. Is it this? Is it this? Is it this? How is this going to play out? What are my reactions going to be? Blah, blah, blah. No, forget it. Just no conclusions. And just, okay. How could there be a little abyss? And we're seeing our stupidity, you know, our silliness, actually. Seeing our loyalty to silliness. Means loyalty to believing there's such a thing as a little abyss. We've been loyal to that. Now, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, the Queen of Wow. She showed me years ago what she's going to do. So I know what she's going to do. But I don't want to draw conclusions about it. What the world wants is scapegoat. So they scapegoat someone they can show my fear and my anger. Look how successful it has been in whipping them, you know, defeating them. So they want an example. They want to carry around an example, see, a trophy, you know, mounted on the wall like a hunting trophy. Fear and anger folks are like hunters, and they want you to be their trophy. And so when you slip away, they don't get to bag you. You're very upset, like I thought they had them on the bag, and it somehow escaped. You know, they're not happy about that, because they want evidence that fear and anger, loyalty to silliness, will defeat, you know, their opposition, the opposition. Otherwise, they start feeling more insecure. But hunters like to look at the trophies on their walls and say, yeah, you know, look at me, I'm a big hunter, look what I was able to bag, you know. I was able to kill that shows I'm a real killer. You know, they like to think that they're real killers. So they want the evidence to keep reminding them of that, because they're inside, they're very secure. Insecure. they want to be secure, but they're insecure. also that video that was put up by one of the intensive group of Sri Anandamayi Ma arriving at a train station. Again, that is super significant. But that's the most famous clip ever. For me, it's the greatest clip ever, video movie ever taken, historic video clip ever taken. Arriving at the train station, and it throngs there, and just she arrived, and everyone totally forgot about the world. The world disappeared. The belief in a world disappeared. But the timing of this is meaning she's on the train. In other words, when the people are at the station, she's already on the train, headed towards the station. So it's just a matter of when does the train pull in the station, and once it does, she's getting off the train and getting on the platform. So it's like the grace of God is headed towards us, and it's just a matter of when does it pull into the station. And so that video clip going up on Facebook, it's saying like, hey, she's pulling into the station right now, and she's getting off the train right now. And her thing seems to be Abode. That's what I was shown, is she's going to help out with our living situation, our abode. She's very great at that. She helped all our devotees actually find places that are more conducive to their spiritual practice. She's an expert at that. Especially when times of strife are about to occur. So you'd have to say that's something that she's a proven expert at. Proven track record there. The partitioning of India and into Pakistan and East Pakistan was a big crisis. And she helped her devotees escape that. Then again in 1971, where the war between East and West Pakistan, the independence war of Bangladesh, there was immense backlash there, and she helped her devotees escape that. Wherever she went, she would change living situations, saying, you know, it's better that you go here. Why don't you come with me? Should she invite people? So come along with me, you know, for a while. And then she'd park them somewhere and say, hey, you know, there's a place here you could stay. And then people would say, oh yeah, we'd like you to stay. So she's always was shuffling living arrangements. So she's the great shuffler of living arrangements. So, but what's indicated is that is now going to come into play. That grace is now in play. So that's what I was shown in a dream long ago. She's going to adjust my living situation. She's the great adjuster of living situations. That's a grace that was active here. She's very active in that way. Active in many other ways too. But that one was very, very evident. And sometimes she'd say, no, you stay where you are. That's the right place for you. But she always knew where the right place for each one of us was in terms of our spiritual practice. So she'll put us in exactly the right place. Now, she has a tall order in my case, but nothing is difficult for her in those terms. It's like I'm a, you know, but she said she loved the challenge. She loved it. She said, oh, yeah, that's not no trouble at all, but I like, you know, all these troublesome living situations, and she sorts it all out, and everything is fixed properly. She said, I love it. I love doing that. So, hey, I'm here. Here's mine, you know. Love this. Love this one. Absolutely. Love this one. It's a doozy. It's really something. But the chess master will make all the right moves. So it's important not to say, well, how is that possible? But just to accept that it's a done deal and it's going to happen. It's going to happen. And since it's going to happen, it's already happened. Might as well start being grateful for it. So we don't get overwhelmed by gratitude later on and get paralyzed by our gratitude. See, it's possible to get paralyzed by gratitude. We don't want that. It's possible to get paralyzed by too much wow. We don't want that. So we want to start feeling the wow right now. Like I'm going to be put in the perfect situation. I certainly am. Which just benefits the Dharma. I said, obviously, everyone who's Dharmic should ask and accept perfect a situation for themselves, because that helps expand the momentum of the Dharma. Okay? That's what it's all about. We're not here to fail. We're not here to do poorly. What is that? That doesn't help the Dharma. We're here to thrive. We're here to be super successful at it. The more great success there is, the better it is for everyone else. So we should ask for great success. Heavy rain's coming tomorrow, Sunday. Okay, so that's a time of maximum turmoil. So let us accept there will be intervention between then and then, now and then. Because I just was told there's going to be a meeting, and I'm sure that there's going to be some rules laid out that are not acceptable to some of us, and it's going to cause a great deal of upset, shock and upset. And that timing, it's being timed right in the time of maximum turmoil and deluge, downpour here in California. So you see how clever the timing is. They choose the timing very cleverly, like that, so to cause you maximum upset and anger and confusion. And then you lose sight of your clarity, simple clarity, of how can there be a little abyss? How can that be? Wow. You lose sight of just the super simplicity of wow. So the very devious, those who are loyal to silliness, are extremely devious in how they time their efforts. This is what I've noticed. They can be so nice up until exactly the right moment, and then suddenly they try to stick you to cause you to fail. That's what they're like. That's what this play is like. They're just waiting for your moment of maximum opportunity to cause you maximum trouble, and then suddenly their other face emerges, and the face of fear and anger emerges, and they try to entrap you, pull you down. So knowing that this is we're under the gun right now, you could say it's Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma time. It's the time for the Queen of Wow to wow us. It's the time for the Queen of Wow to wow us. And she will. So I have to get ready for that. I already thought of a temporary way around it, an emergency way around it. So it's a great time, isn't it? It's the most wonderful time, because the pressure is on us so badly that the Dharma kings now have to make their move. They have to help us. That's great. I would have liked for them to help us earlier. I don't quite understand why they don't, but there has to be a perfect reason for it. If we were acceptable to it, they would have. It's only usually for us only when we realize, wow, we have to let them help us, that we're willing to. Well, because it requires effort on our part to get used to great grace in our lives, right? It's an effort. We're wonderful. Just living in California has been a tremendous effort, actually, on my part. I've really had to just. I had trouble. I mean, it's such a beautiful place, and the weather and the atmosphere. It's, you know, it just, you feel like guilty almost, right? Like, do I really deserve this? And so I've tried to use the opportunity in California here to help strengthen the Dharma. So that's, you know, I'm trying to pay back my good fortune in that way, just to remain inspired and do this taping. California is a big part of it, actually, a very big part of it. And in fact, I'll tell you the truth, is the wonderful place, abode that I'd like to be at, area that I've been at, was so inspiring to me. That's what really helped, is I felt like one day I'll be able to be there. So that so inspired me that I've been able to do all this taping and stay inspired, just because I know my future is so wonderful. Isn't that amazing? So knowing that your future is really wonderful helps inspire us right now, before even the shift takes place. Yeah, I really became inspired when I drove past this place, and some sort of inner voice said, "You're going to live here someday. You're going to live here. This is going to be your home." And then I looked at the place. It was so beautiful. I just was so grateful and just wowed out to such an extent. I said, "Oh, this is just wonderful. Thank you so much." And I became so grateful about this that I was been able to push through all these years. It's been about maybe 15 years or so, I think, really, since I had that experience. I believe about 15 years. Wow. And subscribers reached 1,555. That's a very, very significant number. The 15 and the 55 are there. Because the zip code, part of the zip code is 55, the 55, 55. And wait 15 years. I've been about 15 years. So that means something is coming now. It's really coming. And And then from there, getting glimpses of the Pure Lands, and realize that's where you're going once you leave this delusional situation here, this realm of delusion, going to the Pure Lands, and that's super inspiring to keep working to inspire even more here. So it's because my future is so wonderful that I'm able to maintain my confidence here. If I didn't have that, I couldn't do it. I never saw this before, but this is true. This is where it's really coming from. So to try to remove that future, wonderful future from you would crash my inspiration and confidence. It absolutely would. Of course it would. Wow, I never saw that before. That's why it's so important. Holy cow. Wow. So I was made aware of these wonderful places that I will be. 15 years ago, I was made aware of this and told that one day I will live here. And, you know, just fell in love with the place and just says, I belong here. You know, I really belong here. Because this helps me get to the Pure Lands, but it also helps keep inspiration flowing into the world. So by all means, everyone should, you know, cheer me on, right? Because the better abode that I'm at, the better the inspiration, the better the flow of dharmic support is for everyone else. So may all the Dharma kings be in the most sublime realm imaginable, right? And their experiencing be totally sublime, so that their confidence and inspiration flows down to us. And may our abode adjustment be just right and just perfect, and be, you know, done in a super fast way, super effective way right now, so that our confidence in our future remains sky high. I've always had this really sky-high confidence in my future, awareness of the death-free realms, the beauty there. And so this has enabled me to continue here. Otherwise, if I thought that this world is going to be, you know, quote-unquote, this is my future, so how, you know, and I'd just be in total depression. I mean, you can see it as no world. There is no world, actually, and then everything is beautiful. However, still, as the Queen of Wow said, all of us will eventually have to go to the death-free realm, experience that. We have no choice, so we must go to the pure lands and then ultimately experience, you know, just the total glory of what we are, of what reality is, and function in that way, is the totality, just total glory, ultimately, down the road. So, invitation to the Queen of Wow has been given. It's necessary. Dharmically necessary. So Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, defend the Dharma. Absolutely defend the Dharma. It is, I'm calling dharmic responsibility on you right now. I'm invoking dharmic responsibility. It's a responsibility. Because now I see how pivotal that role is. It's pivotal. Pivotal. Super important. And this keeps alive everyone else's hope that eventually, you know, their abodes will get better. They'll get, you know, you have to have that. Very inspiring. And last time I was down there, last time I was down there, I was shown the turmoil that's to come, actually. And we actually had to leave early there. So I was shown that once the turmoil starts arriving, then I'm probably going to have to make a sudden emergency leaving of where I am and go somewhere else. So this, California, this symbolizes this storm. Symbolizes it, the turmoil. This is really strong turmoil here. And of course, the Trump inauguration is going to cause strong turmoil in California, that is for sure, and around the world. Very strong turmoil and very strong distraction from the Dharma. So we want to maximize your opportunity to get Dharma protection. So I'm a Dharma protector. I mean, I'm very adamant about protecting the Dharma, protecting the momentum. So, like yesterday, my friend fell. I didn't move. I didn't get thrown out of balance. I just stayed calm. I said, you're all right. You're going to be fine. Don't worry. I let him get up on his own power, and he did. I just kept telling him, you're fine. You're okay. You're not hurt, right? And he said, yeah. Well, he wasn't sure, actually. He said, I don't know. I said, no, I saw your fall. It's not bad. He'll be fine. He was just shaken up by the trauma of falling, but he was okay. So, protect the Dharma, we have to say, look, okay, maybe you've fallen for the tricks, but you'll be fine because the Dharma is fine. The Dharma kings are here. The whole chain of authority is here. The chain of grace is here. And nothing has happened to it. I'm fine. I'm great. I'm an example that it's still in place. So this then will enable everyone to get back on their feet after this trip up that's coming, this tricky trip is coming. In 60s lingo slang, a trip means you're going to go through this whole mental scenario. That's what a trip is. You go through a strong mental scenario that really is weird. So there's a trip coming, this really weird trip. The trip was weird. What happened was very weird. Like they even said that, well, that was really weird. So what we're headed for is a very weird trip in the world. And this is going to cause us to lose sight of the Dharma. Many, many to lose sight of it. I didn't lose sight of it. I was in such a position where I stayed calm the whole way through. And then I was there to brush his back off and reassure him. I was there as reassurance. I said, you're fine. You're fine. You're fine. No worries. It was just a weird trip. Now you're back on your feet again. That's all. So the world's just going to go through this weird trip, very weird trip. And then we'll get back on his feet again. The Dharma princess will be there to reassure everyone that everything's fine. And then the momentum will get the momentum back, you know, get up to speed again. It's like that. So, invocation of Dharma protection right now. Dharma responsibility. Full Dharma responsibility invoked fully right now. So you can do this for yourself. Say, full Dharma responsibility, fully invoked, fully right now. Full Dharma responsibility, fully invoked, fully right now. So I know I've helped reassure some here and there. I've had some feedback that I've been very helpful, they say. Very, very helpful. So it just a little thing. Maybe it's just they watch one video and they say, okay, I just feel reassured by this. That's fine. And this comes from, again, the Dharma King's showing me this is where you're going to hang out. There's a beautiful place we have for you. I was so peaceful that not last time, which was stormy, which is super unusual. It was very unusual, very weird, the weirdest weather I've ever seen there. I mean, it was bizarre. You could hardly see anything. It was just like this kind of a weird, foggy, haze-like condition with a really strong wind. I couldn't play golf. I felt sick. I mean, I said, I can't play golf in this. I mean, the conditions are too lousy. And I said, this is weird. Very weird. So the whole thing was very weird. So I was tipped off. A very weird time is coming. That was a Dharma King convention in July. I think it was July 28th, 29th, 30th, I think. Maybe we got there the 29th, 30th. Then we had to leave on the 31st instead of staying there. We had to leave. Very weird. The time before that, I was on this golf course. I was the last person out. It was summer. It was kind of summertime, I believe. It was just gorgeous. No, it was Thanksgiving, but it was gorgeous. And it was so peaceful and serene. Bighorn sheep came down from the mountain. I was just like in another world. It was so amazing. It was so wonderful. I just said, wow, don't want to leave this. There's this feeling of vast spaciousness and peace and calm. So I said, you know, can I handle this? I said, yeah, I can handle it. I already did. Everything worked out perfectly for me. You know, it really did. So again, full Dharma responsibility. We fully invoke full Dharma responsibility fully right now. Okay? So this is, you know, the call has been given out now. Call has been given. The full call has been given. My knee is feeling better. It still hurts. It still has some stability issues. It's not perfect, but it's feeling better and better and better. Fitness-wise, I'm pretty decent and sore here and there, but I feel did my ab work this morning. Strong ab work, strong balance work. You know, strong core work. I've done stairs last week. I did a lot of stairs, walking and running stairs. So that you know, leg work is there. So it's all still going on. Everything is still going on. So the diet's still going on. So all my good habits are still in place and ongoing. So nothing is out of kilter, really. Nothing is out of kilter. It's just this, you know, abode question is on the front burner here. Has to be, right? It has to be for us, for everyone. This inauguration is going to, you know, it's going to kick off turmoil, right? Doesn't matter what side of the fence you're on. Turmoil is turmoil. It distracts you from the Dharma, one way or the other. It doesn't matter. So don't get involved in it in any which way. It is what it is. It's going to be there. There's no way of avoiding it. I mean, it's impossible to avoid turmoil with Trump as president. The opposition is just going to absolutely become as scared as they're what they're working on is they're trying to make themselves extremely frightened. This is how they work, and they're not going to work in some other way, because extreme fear generates extreme anger. Okay, and then they think they can tap that anger for extreme activism and block whatever he wants to do. So this is how they work. This is how they operate. Always. There's no love there. They don't operate from the standpoint of love. They operate from the standpoint of fear. Fear and anger. Fear and loathing. Fear, anger, loathing, activism is their game plan. So that's what's going to happen. Happened in the 60s, I know. We thought the 60s was all full of love. There was a lot more fear than love. Okay, there was some love, but there was more fear. The attempt to get everyone super fearful towards the establishment. Like, they're going to destroy everything. They're going to destroy the planet. They always say they're going to destroy everything, bring ruination in every direction. You know, the atomic bomb, we're going to be in a nuclear war. You got to defeat these people. They're evil. They're evil. They're evil. And be super angry. Get angry. Get fired up with anger. That's the whole activist thing. And this blinds us to the Dharma, the real option. The real problem is our mental conceit, which is loyalty to silliness, the conceit that we need to sanctify ourselves. Okay, so all this arguing is over how do we sanctify ourselves, which means how do we ignore that the goal of sanctifying ourselves is completely absurd, right? That's what they're really doing, the two sides of the coin, of ignoring absurdity. What the Dharma is, the whole idea is to recognize absurdity. And say, hey, wait a minute, that's totally absurd. And then say, stupid, I'm not going to do that anymore. I don't need to sanctify eternal life. How do you sanctify eternal life? That's absurd. I am eternal life. All is eternal life. I don't need it. No sanctification needed. That's completely absurd. How absurd. I don't want to do that anymore. That's the Dharma. That's the Dharma. So they're trying to avoid the Dharma. So in the 60s, we think there was a lot of Dharma. Really, there was a lot of avoiding the Dharma taking place in the 60s, and it trended, ultimately it ended up towards activism, didn't it? Social activism, social movements. That's not the Dharma. Social movements are not the Dharma. The Dharma is all about recognizing this whole dream of conditioned existence is much ado about nothing. It's totally unnecessary. It's total redundancy. It's total silliness. It's total absurdity, and nothing other than that. That's the Dharma. Okay, so if you're not going towards that, it's not happening for you. The Dharma's not happening for you. When you start to recognize, hey, wait a minute, that's absurd, then the Dharma's happening for you. You're letting it happen for you. Just let it happen for you. So I still have my groove, you know, taping-wise, obviously, getting back in shape. And again, absurdity, loyalty to silliness, absurdity cannot understand the Dharma. Cannot. They won't let it happen for them. So, you know, no explanation will work then for them. So we just have to keep making sure that we're capable of inspiring you to get up off the floor of absurdity. You know, and let the Dharma start happening for you. Because most people don't let it happen for them. Because the Dharma, again, is all about recognizing our mistakes, the mistake of absurdity, our loyalty to silliness. It's absolute. The Dharma is absolute. Absolute. Abstraction. Absolute. No compromise. There's nothing to compromise with. There's no other to compromise with. And so most have not allowed that to happen for themselves. So they're on the ground right now. And they want to think like, hey, being on the ground is the right condition. That's what everyone should be. So how come you're not on the ground? Come fall down on the ground with us. That's non-dharmic. That's non-dharmic. And we have to decline the invitation. Because so everyone has to get up. So there has to be those to encourage them to get up. That's dharmic. What they're saying is there shouldn't be any dharma at all. You know, redefining dharma is really saying that there should be no dharma at all. And most efforts in the world are towards redefining dharma in such a way that say everybody should be fallen, you know, on the ground. Don't worry, it's just a little abyss. All right, that's what they're saying. Don't worry, there's just a little. It's just a little. Just think of it as a little abyss, and you'll be fine. Are you worried about it? That's okay. We have the cure. Just think of it as a little abyss, not as a big abyss. Just a little abyss, and you'll be fine. Okay, that's total absurdity. There's no such, that's a non sequitur. The little abyss is a total non sequitur, isn't it? I mean, or that's not the right term, but it doesn't follow. You know, it doesn't follow. There's no little and abyss don't go together at all. An abyss engenders panic. There's no such thing as little about it. You have no idea where you are. That inspires panic. So, you know, we've been too clever, haven't we? We've been, but it's really very simple cleverness. If Dharma helps you recognize how obvious it is, whereas non-dharmic thought, you never recognize how the obviousness of it. So there's no momentum. So you have to go dharmic. In other words, that just means you have to repent. Christianity means you have to repent. Other traditions, you have to be dharmic. You have to go dharmic. Same thing. So there's no wiggle room here. People keep saying, well, our tradition's different. No, there's no wiggle room. There's no wiggle room at all. Labels, two different labels for the same thing isn't any wiggle room at all. So if the Dharma Kings want this sort of taping to continue and this sort of inspiration to continue, well, they'll have to do something. They'll have to do something. So it's highly likely they will do something, isn't it? That's their dharmic responsibility. Because otherwise I won't be able to continue really this inspirational outpouring. Because those activists, the fear, anger, and activism folks, they want me on the ground. They want me on the ground. They want to say, look, he agrees with what we're doing. He agrees with what we're doing. Or look at this trophy. We are able to pull him down. We feel really fired up. It's working. The activism is working. Look, we are able to pull him down. So I wonder what came in the mail today. I'm waiting for a CD, actually. There's one CD. There's only one thing that hasn't yet arrived. Beach Boy CD, of course. Shutdown Volume 2, also including Surfer Girl. It's like it's two albums in one. I mean, those two albums are just absolutely mind-blowing. Surfer Girl and Shutdown Volume 2. I mean, you talk about musicality. So, but that's not enough. I need an abode adjustment. I need an abode adjustment. I need an abode adjustment. One abode adjustment coming up. So, let me go check to see if that CD arrived. And maybe they just shipped it. I mean, maybe it's there. Let me just hold on. Just be, just realize, just look at, hey, little abyss. Just focus, little abyss, is that really possible? Okay, not there. Usually those CDs get here quick, real fast. So, it's sad. I hope it arrives today in some other fashion. Maybe UPS or Amazon or something. I ordered on Amazon, so maybe Amazon will zip in and, you know, we'll put it on the porch or something. They're pretty good about that. That'll be cool, because it's got In the Parking Lot, one of my favorite songs. Is just this spacious kind of floatiness, beautiful floatiness. Definitely a lot of conflict going on. My throat is not good. My singing voice is not good. It's means there's a lot of stress going on right now. Sure there is. I mean, the gauntlet's being thrown down. So, miracles should be on the way right now. They are on the way. This is either they're already on the way. So I don't want to put fear into the situation. I want to see when you pray, affirm. Don't pray, affirm. So that's really important. Don't pray, affirm. Praying is not correct. Affirming is correct. Praying brings doubt and fear into the situation. You're praying from a fearful, doubtful perspective. Don't do that. Affirm that miracles are on the way. There's no question about it. Miracles are on their way, even as I speak. Super miracles are on their way. Super miracles are on their way. A vast array of super miracles are on their way, even as I speak. Full invocation, a full dharmic responsibility, fully right now. Full miracles are on their way. Right now. Fully right now. Yeah. Super commotion is taking place. Super commotion is taking place right here as the heavier stuff is headed our way as we head towards Saturday afternoon. Supposed to get about 36 hours of straight rain, heavy rain, and it's probably about going to start pretty soon here. It's about 3 o'clock right now. Those 36 hours would be it'd be 3 a.m. Monday morning till 3 a.m. Monday morning, starting right about now. The 3 a.m. Monday morning. That's possible. It's kicking up a fuss right now. It could mean this is, you know, the blustery front before the heavy stuff. And it's supposed to just kind of sit over us and dump. The dumping hasn't happened yet. And then the world's about ready to dump on us, isn't it? At least try to. So I've laid it out really beautifully. I'm comfortable with how I've laid it out. I just don't like waiting. So let's say waiting is over. The waiting is over. Abode adjustment is here. The abode adjustment is here. So may everyone's abode be adjusted appropriately right now so that it's optimal for the spiritual path, the successful spiritual path. Especially for the ones who are able to encourage and inspire others and not fall at all. That their abodes be now, they shift into those abodes so that they're able to help out. That saves a lot of anger and upset and delay. I was able to help the one who took the fall. I was able to just laugh and help them laugh it off. Instead of getting angry and just help them laugh it off and get their confidence back. I just helped them regain their confidence quickly. And so that really, you know, in terms of delay, that saves a lot of delay. The quicker we regain our confidence, the quicker it goes, the better it goes for us. We want a quick return to confidence. In the Dharma. Quick return to confidence in the Dharma. Let the Dharma happen for you. The Dharma is something that happens for you as you see absurdity as absurd. You say, I don't want that. That's absurd. And you see absolute. Say, oh, that's absolute. That's what I want. You see that. So the Dharma is something you let happen for you. It's already within you. You just have to let it happen. You have to let it emerge. You have to let the clouds clear for a moment. And then right away you notice, oh my gosh, yeah. And different people have different places that's optimal for them. It's not always going to be the same place for all of us right now. You know, wherever you're at, there may be somewhere you just feel like, this place is so, I feel so peaceful here. I feel this peace and easement here. I feel a sense of peace and easement. Well, that could be the place for you. In some places, you'll feel the turmoil. In other places, you'll feel the peace and easement. So you don't want to have activists around. That's the only problem where I'm at. You want those who are into just easement, peace and easement. People are saying, the world's going to die. What world? What world? Wait a minute. Why not so fast? First, establish that there's a world. I don't agree at all that there's any world. That's totally false to the teachings of Dharma that there's a world. Totally false. So if there's no world, you know, what do you talk about a world dying? That's you're getting ahead of yourself there. What needs to die is the belief that there is a world. That's a Dharma, from the Dharma standpoint. Our focus is not on save the world from dying, but save us from the belief that there is a world to die. That's our focus. So totally different focus. And they said, well, can't you do both? That's absurdity. In order to do both, you have to both believe that there is a world and believe that there isn't a world. Or know that there's no such thing as a world and then know that there is such a thing as a world. To believe that contradiction is sanctification. And it's not. That's absurdity. Contradiction's absurdity. And it's, you know, that's totally weird to think that way. Completely weird. So it's a weird trip. Totally weird trip to believe that. It's absurdity. It's a believing that absurdity sanctifies. So you say, well, if you just sanctify yourself, you'll be able to help us. Well, weirdness does not sanctify. Nothing sanctifies. We're already sanctity itself. There's nothing that sanctifies. So stop searching for something that sanctifies. There isn't anything. This is true. This is true. This is true. We don't need to be sanctified. Nothing needs to be sanctified. And there's nothing that sanctifies. So the search for something that sanctifies is just total absurdity. Okay. Maybe I'll eat something today. Yeah, but if I do, I won't lose any weight. Crazy. It's amazing. You want to save the quote-unquote world, just accept the Dharma. It's funny, all these people say save the world, they're not accepting the Dharma. They're trying to define it. You should be social activists. You should be activists. Hey, Dharma, come on, be more activist. Hey, Dalai Lama, be more activist. Come on, get with... That's what they try to do. They try to bully the Dharma into being non-dharmic. That's not Dharma. Dharma is to let it happen for you. That's Dharma. Starts with you. And let it start happening for you. They want Dharma to be like, join the fearful, angry activists. But if you become dharmic, maybe you won't eat so much. Your needs will be vastly reduced. As long as people are full of fear and anger, they're going to have all these needs. And the key people say, we need to cut down on our consumption. Well, then you need peace of mind to do that. Those who are fearful and angry are frantic consumers. And they'll fight over this issue. They'll fight for their food and for consumption. So it's like completely absurd to promote fear and anger and at the same time demand, you know, less consumerism. It's totally conflicted. Totally non-dharmic. The Queen of Wow, Sri Anandamayi Ma, was so dharmic, so perfectly dharmic, she didn't need to eat anything. Didn't need to consume anything. Nothing at all. She said, I don't need to eat anything, but I'll for your sake, I'll eat something. I'll eat a grain of rice a day. As long as that grain of rice is very dharmic. I'll eat a fingertip of rice each day. And so she made these deals, but she didn't need to eat anything. She says, the body can be nourished just straight from the ether, so to speak, from the essence of the air, she said. It's just, you don't actually need to eat anything. The body doesn't need to consume anything. It's just a reflection. Consumption is just a reflection of your non-dharmic mind. Your loyalty to silliness is what brings about these needs for the body entirely. That's a fact. She helped establish this fact. Well, facts are never established, they just are. But she helped bring our attention to it. She didn't need to drink, didn't need to eat, nothing, but they freaked everybody out. So she agreed, made some deals, said, okay, I'll eat a little bit, tiny bit, I'll drink a tiny bit, and we'll call it good. They said, okay, as long as you have a little, did you have your little fingertip of rice today, and did you drink a little sip, a little liquid? Yes? Okay, thank you, we're good. But, yeah, So she was playing this game with him, showing, hey, you know, wake up to the Dharma. She's, you know, being perfectly dharmic, and which also is pragmatic enough to say, okay, you want a little deal? I'll make a little deal. It's a little temporary deal just to keep your fear levels down. It doesn't mean that she needs to eat. So see, that's not really a deal. In other words, what they were asking says, we want you to have a need to eat. And she said, no, I don't make any such deal. I don't have any need to eat, but I will eat to help your fear out. So she put the burden where it really is on our fear, not on her. She didn't have any fear. She didn't have any needs. So it wasn't a compromise or a deal as far as her being fearful at all. That's what the non-dharmic silliness wants. And she did not cave into that. She did not. And neither should we. Because again, there's nothing to cave into. There's no other. There's no otherness. And if we're trying to represent the otherness, you know, so give up representing the otherness. Like we're like speaking on his behalf. Well, you know, if there was an otherness, it would be like this. And so, you know, that's absurd, right? There is no otherness. So why should we keep fronting for some non-existent otherness? Why should we keep fronting for a non-existent otherness? Why should we keep fronting for a non-existent otherness? That's all we're doing. There is no otherness. We're just fronting for a non-existent otherness. Say, well, yeah, but it could be like this, you know, so we're speaking for it. It can't speak for itself, so we're speaking for it. It can't act for itself. It can't demand for itself, so we're demanding for it. Well, of course it can't demand for itself because it doesn't exist. There is no otherness. It can't speak for itself. It can't demand for itself. It can't do anything for itself because it doesn't exist. There is no such thing. So we're fronting for a non-existence. We're fronting for non-existence. Putting up a front for it. I'll speak for it. I'll act for it. I'll die for it, you know. Christians even say that Jesus died for this non-existent otherness, so that God would finally get it, you know. God would finally listen and make a deal with this non-existent otherness. See, God, this listen to Jesus. He had died for this. He fronted for non-existent otherness and died for it. There is no not otherness. So we can't get God to agree there's some otherness. That's what we were hoping for. Jesus died for this non-existent otherness. Now God would finally agree, okay, there is this otherness to eternal life. There is this deathness. And there's eternal life, and then there's not eternal life. No, there's only eternal life. There's only eternal life. There is no otherness. There is no death. There is no death at all. We're just fronting for non-existence of death. You know, it says, well, there isn't any death, but we'll front for it and pretend to die. It's all our own pretense. Death needs death. All this is just complete imagination, pretense, our own imagination, our own pretense. There's no reality to it at all. We're just fronting for what doesn't exist. So just give up the fronting. Give up the frontingness. You know, we're just fronting for it. I'll speak for it. Yeah, there's not eternal life. Therefore, it must die, but it doesn't exist. But so I'll pretend that it exists by pretending to die myself. But I'm just pretending. All death is pretense, 100%. All death is 100% pretense. As Jesus says, it's all suicide. We die by our own hand. But even further than that, there isn't any death at all. It's pretense isn't real. So we're pretending to die, but there's never any death at all. None. It's all our pretense. It's all just our imagination. Beyond imagination, we're pretending. We're pretending. Say, God, this is what non-eternal life it really is about, but you just can't see it, but I'll show it to you. This is what it's about. See, this is what dying's about, God. God says, well, you're just pretending. Beyond the pretense, is there any actual otherness? No. Well, you just can't see it, God. Well, I can't see it because it's not there. There's nothing to see. That's why it's not my lack of seeing it. It's because there's nothing there to see. Okay, so that's dharmic. Whereas absurdity says, well, God, you just can't see it. God says, no, that's my, not the problem is not with my eyesight or my seeing. Problem is, there's no problem because it's not there to see. Okay, so we flip the non-dharmic into a dharmic realization, recognition. We flip absurdity. Say, oh, that's absurdist. That's the path. That's the path. Just keep flipping the script like that. Keep flipping your internal script. Keep recognize the absurdity and flip it. Say, no. There's nothing there to see. It's not a lack of awareness on God's part. It's not like God's not aware of non-eternal life and that Jesus' death helped God become aware of non-eternal life. That's absurdity. It's absurdity. No, God's awareness is perfect. There's no non-eternal life to be aware of. So there's no stain or lack of awareness, God's awareness at all. So, abode adjustment, am I worth it? Well, I'm not going to draw any conclusions about that. I'm just going to stay in the well. I have no conclusions. I'm not going to draw any conclusions. I have to protect myself that way. When the grace of God acts in a strong way, as far as like abode adjustment, it's so big that you don't want to draw any conclusions. So I invoke the right to full stop in the wow about this question. I'm not going to answer that question. I'll just keep doing the best I can, but I'm not going to answer that question. Am I worth it? I refuse to answer that question. That's drawing a conclusion. I refuse to draw conclusions in such a way. Just full stop in the wow. That's the practice I stand on. So we know that going in. It's just wind. It's just wind right now. I mean, there's really very little rain at all coming down. Just wind. Very, 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 very turbulent. Weird. Was this another dud? The Dud Express? they keep saying the Pineapple Express is just going to inundate you. The last couple of years they've been saying that, and it just never turned up. Never turned up at all. But so they keep saying this one is the one that's going to just crush us. Well, so far, there's very little rain. Very little. Just drizzle, kind of. Spritzels, sprinkles. Sprinkles, spritzels, drizzles. So we're waiting. I don't know how they can possibly miss it. I mean, they have ways of measuring moisture content, the jet stream. I mean, the parameters are not difficult to measure. So, I mean, how difficult can it possibly be? Otherwise, other than wishful thinking on their parts, getting in the way of the data or something. I mean, the data must be there. Or hype, you know, hype. Nothing gets a set of eyes on the TV more than a huge storm is coming. I mean, that's just money in the bank for them. You know, massive ratings. A mega storm. The storm of the century is coming. Everybody's going to, you know, nonstop watch the television and then, watch all the commercials and the trailers and, you know, that's big time for them. Big storm is big time for all the media outlets. So they are always crying wolf. Always crying wolf. It's amazing. Super tabloid crying wolf. We're like, whatever, what's going on? They said this. Like last week they said it was going to get really cold. It didn't. Never did. It was like 40s. It was no cold at all. And then they stopped telling us it was going to get cold, and suddenly a 28 pops up. Like yesterday morning was really cold. I said, you know, they totally missed it. Maybe they should, like just one day in advance. They should, you know, just give us one day and just give us 12 hours heads up. Come on. That's not asking too much. Okay, so Dharma, full Dharma responsibility invoked. Full Dharma responsibility, fully invoked, fully right now, fully on. Here we go. Dharma responsibility, here we go. Full stop in the wow, no conclusions. No conclusions, John. So, this has been one of my favorite tapings. Every taping is one of my favorites. You know, they always go well. They always go, almost always go well, I would say. Even when they don't go well, they go well. And this has been a gem. I've just been super helpful for me to be able to, express, show that I can talk in this way, express this way, have this adamant tone in this way. Really, really helpful. But it's time to draw it to a close. I wish it would just go on forever, actually. I just would like to just continually express in this way. But I know we all have limits right now, feeling like, well, and so we will draw it to a close. Very great. That's it for this one.